When your teacher takes attendance in class, does she say POOJA MEENU? No, she doesn't say like that, right? She says Pooja, Meenu, and so on. So when alphabets combine, they give words. And there's a definite way of reading and saying those words. Similarly, the language of chemistry. It has the symbols as its alphabets. When the chemical symbols combine, they give the chemical formulae. And there's a definite way of reading and saying those chemical formulae. Let's see how we say or read those chemical formulae. So let's recall. We know the elements which have 1, 2, or 3 electrons in the valence shell. They can easily lose these electrons, and these are the metals. The elements which have 5, 6, or 7 valence electrons, they can gain electrons to complete their octet, and these elements are the non-metals. The elements which have 4 valence electrons, they can share electrons, and so these are the metalloids. So whenever in a compound we have a metal and a non-metal, how do we read that? So we read the name as the metal is written first and it's followed by the non-metal, and the suffix -id is added to the non-metal. So now we have a compound which has calcium and nitrogen. Calcium is the metal, nitrogen is the non-metal. So how do we read out this compound? So we read it out as this. We read it as calcium nitride. So we know that the metal is written first. Calcium is the metal, it's written first. Then the non-metal. Nitrogen is the non-metal, it's written after the metal. Now the suffix -ide is added to the non-metal. You'll observe that we are not naming this as nitrogen and then -ide. Instead, the -ide is merged with the name itself. That is, it is N-I-T-R-I and then D-E. So the I-D-E is merged with the name itself, and it's not nitrogen followed by an -ide. Similarly, say we have another compound formed by potassium and iodine. So in this case, potassium is a metal and iodine is a non-metal. So how do we name this compound? So we first name the metal. So the metal is named as it is, that is potassium. The non-metal gets the suffix -ide. So in this case also, you'll observe that -ide is not added after the non-metal name. So -ide is merged with the name itself. So we get potassium iodide. So whenever we have a compound in which there is a metal and non-metal, how do we name it? We first name the metal and then the non-metal. The suffix -ide is added to the non-metal. So if there's a compound of magnesium and bromine, what is it called? We know magnesium is a metal, bromine is a non-metal. So we write the metal first. So the metal is written as it is, and then the non-metal. The suffix -ide is added to the non-metal and it is merged with the name. So we get bromide. So the name is magnesium, which remains added as it is, and the suffix -ide is added to the non-metal. So the name of this compound is magnesium bromide. Now, you must be wondering, why do we always write the metals before the non-metals? Why do we do this? This is because we follow a rule. And according to that rule, we always write the elements which have lower number of valence electrons before the elements which have higher number of valence electrons. You'll always observe that the number of valence electrons in metals is 1, 2, 3. In case of non-metals, it's 5, 6, and 7. So the metals always have lower number of valence electrons than the non-metals. That is why we write the metals before the non-metals in all the cases. So what should be the name of the compound CaCl2? So we know in this case Ca is the metal, so its name is calcium. Cl is the non-metal, which is chlorine, and the suffix -ide is added to the non-metal. So we get chloride. Now, what else do you observe here? You see a 2 also. This 2 shows that there are 2 chlorine atoms present in this compound. But when we give the name, we do not include this 2. This means we ignore the number of atoms present. We are just concerned with their names. So when we name it, we have calcium and we have the non-metal, that is chloride. So the name of the compound formed by the 2 elements calcium and chlorine is calcium chloride. Similarly, when we have a compound FeCl2, what should this be called? In FeCl2, we know Fe is a metal and chlorine is a non-metal. And while naming the compound, we always name the metal first and then the non-metal. So in this case, we name Fe first. But what is the name of Fe? We know for iron, there are 2 valencies shown. And we use the Latin name of iron. The Latin name of iron is ferrum. So when it shows a lower valency, that is +2, we use the name ferrous. That is, we use the suffix O-U-S. And when it shows a higher valency, that is +3, we use the suffix ic. So the name becomes ferric. So in this case, we always have to check which out of the 2 is used in the compound. So in the compound, that is FeCl2, it can either be ferrous or ferric. So how to check it? Let's see. So for chlorine, we know the valency of chlorine is -1. So when it is -1, if we use ferrous, we know how to write the formulae of the chemical compounds. So when we have ferrous, we write the number 2 ignoring the positive sign. Similarly, for chlorine, we write the 1 ignoring the sign. Then we interchange the valencies. So this 1 superscript becomes a subscript here. And this 2 becomes a subscript here. So we can ignore this 1 and it becomes FeCl2. So when we are using ferrous, we are getting the chemical formula FeCl2. So the chemical name of FeCl2 is ferrous chloride. So now what is the formula if we use ferric instead of ferrous? If we are using ferric, it becomes Fe3Cl1. We interchange the valencies. This 1 can be ignored and we get 3. So the formula of ferric chloride is FeCl3. So whenever we are writing the name of a chemical compound using a metal which shows variable valencies, in this case we had Fe which shows variable valency. That is, when it has a valency +2, it is known as ferrous. So if you are using ferrous, we name it as ferrous chloride. If you are using a compound of iron having a valency +3, we use the name ferric. So now in this case it becomes ferric chloride.